And never, and it has to be, they hope, of an equal or have enough things in common in the marriage.
Yes, and generally marriages work very well in India, even though they are arranged.
Yeah.
So that's another picture of doorways made for wedding, you know, preparation for weddings in that area.
Yeah.
This is Indra. This is the woman who still lives behind the veil, who's never been seen by any other foreigner, not only foreigner, any other male other than those in her immediate family before me. And it's this friend Karen that you mentioned, Karen Lucas, who runs Folk Arts Rajasthan, a nonprofit organization based in New York, that opened the doors to enable me to document her. And there, that's Padma.
This child is absolutely, you cannot take your eyes off of her.
She's a real sweetie.
Yeah.
She was 6 years old, and the story here is in this region, in South India, the women in more than a million homes create beautiful drawings in front of their front doors before dawn, every single day of the year.
And they
pride themselves in never repeating a design. It's ephemeral. It just it doesn't exist after another an hour, hour and a half, 2 hours.
Yeah.
And Padma has been watching her mother draw. This is not an unfinished drawing here. And maybe in another picture you can see what they're like when they're finished. And she's been watching her mother draw these all of her life. So now on her sixth birthday, her mother allows her to paint by herself.
Yeah.
And she's just thrilled. So that's sort of the subplot within this. But we're also talking about women's identity and how women find sources of creativity. In this case, Americans will ask me, you know, how do women have the time to do these drawings every day? And the women say, how do we not have the time? It's our chance for a sort of yoga. It's our chance for our own self-expression, our own creativity that's away from our family duties, away from the responsibilities to take care of our children and our husbands and whatever jobs we may have.
And it's also part of their devotion to Lakshmi.
Lakshmi. To the goddess, or to whatever deities they seem, or the gods they worship.
Now we come to
Achama.
This is, let's see, she's the Bill Gates of India, a female Bill Gates.
In a way,
except as she got bigger and bigger and bigger, the big guys took it away from her.
Bought her out, yes. Yeah. It's really been a danger. She started, her husband was a merchant marine, and she became a bored housewife with her young infant son living at home, raising the son. So she began to take night classes in computer programming, and she found that she had a very high acumen for computer programming. So
a
very beautiful woman.
Yeah.
This is in southwestern India, where the system is matrilineal. So possessions go down through the women in that area.
I like that.
And so Achama began to invented her own program, developed her own program, computer program for plantation management that did not exist, not only in India, but anywhere in the world, and developed that into a business that she eventually sold for $30 million. But she's had to work as a woman in a man's world. And in doing so, not only have the men been very aggressive and have been trying to control her life, but as a woman, she's had to let go of many of the sensibilities that she would have wanted to be able, for example, her relationship with her own children has suffered because she has had to work so hard as a businesswoman to make these contacts and maintain the contacts and to sell her business, her business acumens, not only in India, but worldwide.
Yeah. And the daughter, who is 16, is off at boarding school.
Is off at boarding school. Yeah. So she's, you know, because her mother's never at home, she's traveling around the world. So
and
there's
the
a loss of that.
And the husband has gone to live in a different city.
Oh, well, actually, Achma has gone to live in a different city. So they're estranged. So, you know, there's a suffering. And that we find is reflected. I mean, Achama is very much a modern, a contemporary 21st century woman in any culture.
Yeah.
And, you know, we find some of those same problems in our own culture.
All right. Now we come to where people are washing the clothes in the river. Yeah. It's the old world.
Yes, and this is Kusima. Kusima is a woman. May I go back one page? This is Kusima, and Kusima is a widow who would have had a life that would have been fairly good, except that her infant child was given a polio vaccine when he was a baby of 1 year old and caught polio. He was given too much vaccine. And he's believed by the local villagers to have the evil eye. Yeah. So he cannot go to school. He cannot get any jobs. No children will play with him. So her life is spent protecting him.
And yet, as a widow, she wasn't treated like most Indian widows were treated.
No, I don't agree with that. She was not treated in the way that most Westerners think that Indian widows are treated.
Excuse me.
And that's part of what I'm trying to do in this book, is to challenge people's stereotypes of what they think. Not all of Indian widows are treated as they are depicted in the fine movie Water. Yeah. Now, Water is a magnificent movie, and it does address very serious issues in India, but there are many widows who are very cherished by their families throughout the subcontinent. Yeah. And it would be wrong to view widowhood as a symbol of rejection in India. It is not.
And here comes a beauty.
Minhas is a woman, a Muslim woman from Assam in northeastern India, who now lives in Delhi and works as an advocate for folk artists. She tries a nonprofit. Mm-hmm. She's an NGO. She works trying to make sure that folk artists, artisan craftspeople, most of them Hindu, get a fair shake, that they get a fair deal in transactions because the middlemen take almost everything.
Yeah.
So she's trying to protect their interests. And now the problem that Minhas is coming up, I mean, I've been in close contact with Minhas over these last weeks and months, and there have been serious violence of bombings in Delhi where she lives. Mm-hmm. And she says she is being forced into, against her will, into allying herself with Muslim fundamentalism, not because she's not a fundamentalist. She's a very open-minded woman. She doesn't agree with that, but because the bombers are Muslim, the Hindus are forcing her to take sides, and she doesn't want to. She doesn't want to. She feels an open, you know, there should be open communication between religions.
Her husband works with her?
Works with her.
Yeah.
And runs this nonprofit organization with her.
Now, with what's going on, are they forcing her back into wearing the veil and burqa?
No, not in India. That is not a situation in India yet. And we hope that it will never happen.
Okay.
Gani Devi. Gani Devi is actually the mother of a close friend of mine. She lives in the mountains of the Himalayas, the foothills of the Himalayas, and in a wooden house. It's beautiful. And she is painting a beautiful floor design, similar to the one that the little girl Padma would created. Yeah. But here it's not done every day, and it's just done for weddings.
Yeah.
And she's creating this beautiful lotus. I'll flip one picture over so you can see it in more detail right there. She's creating a lotus in front of her front door to welcome the goddess in to protect the house, but also to welcome the new bride. Her youngest son has just been married, and she is welcoming the new bride into the house, welcoming the goddess, which is the goddess of prosperity and abundance. So to welcome good into the house with the new marriage.
And for 3 weeks, she will give up her bedroom so that the new young couple can have some privacy.
Absolutely, yeah.
Because they don't know each other usually before they're married.
No, that's right. That's very true. And yet, you know, often marriages that are arranged are very good, very lasting in India. There's far less cases of divorce in India than there are in America and in many Western countries, not only because they are not traditional, because we do have a sort of tradition of divorce, but also because they seem to be compatible. Yeah.
I was going to ask you the influence of this woman on you.
Suniti.
Yeah.
Suniti was my major mentor in India for many years. She died about 6 or 8 years ago. And it was a tremendous loss. She was a a remarkably evocative storyteller. She could bring stone alive. She could make sculptures live. She could make paintings come to life. And the mythology,